Greetings, adventurers. It's your humble wizard archmage Feng here. I'm not doing a book review this time. I'm going to do something completely different. I'm going to do a comparison between two systems. I'm not going to hate on one and like the other or anything like that. I'm just going to see what's different. The systems I'm going to do is 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons, which has gone through a lot of changes ever since the days of original Dungeons & Dragons of Gary Gygax and Dave Arneson. And of course, because a lot of people enjoy original Dungeons & Dragons, I've played it, I thought it was quite good. I'm also going to do Dungeon Crawl Classics because, although it is tied with the way original D&D, it's the same type of game, there's quite a lot of differences as Goodman Games have added their own spice, their own flavour to it, and I feel, well, I should compare the two. Why not? Let's have a bit of fun. So, stay tuned, and yeah, we'll discuss them both in depth.
The first thing you notice on each game is the artwork on the books. Dungeons & Dragons 5th edition went with that computer-generated artwork, which is quite good, but it doesn't really compare to the old-school hand-drawn art that DCC has gone for. They've gone for that old-style artwork, which I feel is a lot better than D&D's. DCC has also small comic scenes, which sort of add a bit of humour to the artwork. With DCC, it borrows some of the old original D&D style. It has elves, dwarves and halflings as a class, for example. The rest of the class roster is just old school gaming, really. Warrior, wizard, thief and cleric, just filling it out. Creating characters involve a good old fashioned 3d6 rolling order, which I think is the best way, but it can put off some players, especially if they had a heart and say playing a warrior, but say they rolled an 8 for strength, so they had to play a lower class. Edition is different with the 4d6 drop lowest, which not only gives you higher stats, but it allows you to put them wherever you want. I suppose that does appeal to other players as they can create the character they want to play. Personally though, I think the old way is better because you don't know what type of character you're going to get. That's what makes it fun, that's what makes it interesting. It's like being born, you know, you don't know what you're going to be in life. The stats of course are different. 5th edition fielding the usual D&D, strength, dexterity, constitution, intelligence, wisdom and charisma. DCC is a little different. It has strength, agility and stamina, which replace dexterity and constitution. It also puts wisdom and charisma together into personality, which is different. Of course, the sixth stat is luck. Luck is different to all the other stats. Luck can be burned to gain bonuses, like for example, if you go to attack someone and you feel unconfident with a roll, you can say, right, I'm going to burn 3 luck to add +3 to that roll. However, once you've used your luck, you don't get it back. Only the thief and the halfling can actually regain luck. Halflings also have another unusual ability which allows them to give luck to others. Saves in 5th edition also come from the stats, so for example the player, if they need to make a strength saving throw or a dexterity saving throw, or it's based on their stats. Dungeon Crawl Classics follows the old 3rd edition ideal of using fortitude, reflex and will. Each class has their own. Classes work differently as well, obviously. DCC does break the mould by having the players start off as level 0 peasants with limited equipment, low hit points, and just basically throwing them into a dungeon to see who survives, really. Any that do survive become level 1 adventurers. To qualify as demi-humans, obviously, you need to roll on the career table as a peasant and get the elf, dwarven, or halfling careers, and then once you get to level 1, they then become dwarves, elves, or halflings. Again, it's based on whatever your primary status, so if you got like say 15 strength and everything else is rubbish, then you'd be best off being a fighter or a warrior. The thing that I do miss from the original D&D and AD&D which they put in, which I think they should have put into Dungeon Crawl Classics, is the added percentile that you get for having a high primary stat. Like for example, if you were a thief and you had 16 dexterity, then you'd get 10% extra experience. I think that would have been pretty good, and I think I might use that in my future games of Dungeon Crawl Classics. It can be daunting with only 7 class choices, and you know, your roles and career choices affect what class you're going to be. But with a bit of thought behind it, you can really play the class you want. I mean, for example, if you think, oh, there's no bards, then you know, play a thief, take an instrument. Now, there you go, you're a bard basically. If you think, oh, I want to play a ranger, then take the elf class because they have patron bond, and take the patron bond king of elfland, give them leather armor and a bow because obviously they're weakness to iron, basically got a ranger, because they can also cast magic like a wizard, just give them nature-based spells. Sorted. Okay, well, another thing that, unlike D&D, is characters get abilities based on D&D, characters get abilities based on their level. So a fighter at like this one level can disarm an opponent. Then as they level up and get another level, they can throw sand or dirt in an enemy's face. DCC allows the warrior to do that at first level. They get a D die, which starts with a D3, then goes up to D5 and so on. As you roll a 3 or a higher, then you can do that D. So you can say, right, I'm going to hit them with my sword, and I'm going to use my D die to throw sand in their face. You roll it, you get a 3, you throw sand in their face. I'm going to use it to knock the shield out of their hand. Roll it again. And you can do that every turn. I think that's quite a good mechanic to have. Different mechanics for different classes as well. So the dwarf, for example, does sword and board. So they can use D20 for the main attack and then use a shield to swipe with a shield or hit with a shield at D16. I know you're thinking, what's a D16 and that? Where did you get that from? I'll explain that later. Let's move on to skills. Skills are nearly non-existent except for the thief. Thieves have their own set of skills like climbing walls and hiding in shadows, backstabbing, which is a fun one. You can get like basic checks like perception and stuff like that. They're based on stats, like for example, perception is based on intelligence. If you're doing an investigatory scene, like for example, the seed scattered on the floor, well, who in your party was a farmer as a peasant, they'll be able to make an intelligence roll to assess that. Or there's a sword lying on the ground, but it's made of a weird metal. What weird metal is that? Well, ask the peasant who was a blacksmith. He'll be able to make an intelligence check. If the farmer was to make an intelligence check on, say, the sword, they would roll a D16 because they're not really skilled and know what the material of the sword is. They don't work with metal. Whereas the blacksmith would know what the C's were, so they would roll that at D16. If they rolled it based on a skill they're qualified in, like metal for blacksmith, then they'd roll a D20. Clerics and wizards, they work very differently to 5th edition. Unlike D&D, with all the editions really, clerics turn undead. That's it, they hold an holy symbol, undead, they run away or explode. Clerics in Dungeon Crawl Classics, however, turn different creatures based on their alignment, and they can use different weapons tied to that alignment. They don't have to be like a war cleric to use all the weapons, or they don't have to be... They're three alignments, lawful, neutral and chaotic, and they do affect each class, but they mainly affect the clerics. Lawful clerics can turn undead, demons, devils, chaotic extraplanar creatures, monsters such as basilisks and medusas, chaos prime, chaos humanoids like orcs, chaotic dragons, and these the basic cleric weaponry such as clubs, maces, slings and staffs and hammers. Neutral clerics, which I find quite fun, which I'll explain why, they can turn mundane animals. So, you know, have fun making cows and chickens for you. You know, get your warrior to build a catapult, turn a cow to make it run towards the catapult and then shoot it like a Monty Python, you know? Why not? They can also turn undead, demons, devils, monsters such as basilisks or medusas, lycanthropes, werewolves, perversions and natives such as otyugs and slimes, and they wield daggers, maces, slings, staffs and any type of sword. This is why I like neutral clerics, because you can actually take Cthulhu as your god. Yep, you can worship Cthulhu. Anyway, moving on, chaotic clerics, they turn angels, paladins, lawful dragons, lords of law, lawful primes, or any law-aligned humanoids such as goblins. And they wield any axe, any bow, daggers, darts and flails. So there's a lot of variety there really, before you even start to get to the magic. Which is done by a spell roll for both wizards and clerics. Elves as well, because elves can cast magic. For clerics, for them to cast a spell, they roll, the higher the spell roll, the better the effect. If they get a 1, they get what's known as disapproval, which is where the god like just goes, nah, I don't like that, or they're busy doing something, or things like that. Every time they get disapproval, though, their critical fail for everything goes up, so instead of being just 1 for a crit fail, it goes up to 2, it goes up to 3, it goes up to 4. It basically gets to the point where the cleric will start losing abilities, such as the lay on hands, which is important because that's their healing, or they start to lose certain amount of spells. They can also earn disapproval by sinning against their god. So what do they do to get rid of disapproval? Well, they go on quests for penance and things like that, such as wearing nothing but simple robes and carrying a staff and being branded a heretic, and if they survive, then you know they get all their abilities back and the god likes them again. Healing works different as well. Like with D&D, you get like cure light wounds, or you get cure medium wounds or something like that, and you roll a certain dice. With this, they get a lay on hands, where what they do is they get their hit dice based on the character's class, level and their alignment. So for example, if they're a lawful cleric and they see a lawful fighter, they'll take the The fighter's level, say it's 3. They'll take what their hit dice is, which is a d12, so it'll be 3d12. Plus, they get bonuses for the fact that they're also lawful as well, so it could be 5d12. You can heal. You can also use these hit dice to do stuff like heal broken limbs, cure blindness, cure disease, that type of thing. Again, if they crit fail, then they earn disapproval. And also, they can get disapproval for sinnings, such as healing someone from an opposite alignment, or healing someone the god might deem unworthy. It becomes quite interesting from there. Wizards, sort of like, they take the 5th edition counter, so you've got sorcerers, you've got warlocks, and you've got wizards. With DCC, they sort of take the 3 classes and just meld them into one. For example, they've got the spell book, which wizard has, obviously. But they get additions such as spell burn, mercurial magic, and patron bonding. So spell burning is where, as a wizard, you burn a stat to add bonuses to spell casting rolls. So you might say, I'm going to sacrifice 2 dexterity to get a +2 on my next spell casting roll. You get these back, obviously as you rest you get them back, but you sort of, it's like, yeah, you basically like just get a knife and cutting your hand or something, and then you go, oh, sacrifice 2 dexterity by cutting my hand. And then it adds to the, the thing is with spellcasting, again, it's a spellcaster check like clerics, however, if they quickly fail, then they get corrupted, this is when they grow tentacles and get a beak and, you know, the hands become claws, just really weird, wacky stuff. Magic is very pricey and is very risky in the DCC universe. However, the higher the wizard rolls, the more powerful the spell. So you can take a magic missile and go from 1d4 to 12d4. And this is ever throwing like bolts of energy. It can be like meteors, or it can be like bolts of fire. It's just wild. Mercurial magic. Now this is something I do actually like and I enjoy. Every spell the wizard gets, they roll on the mercurial magic chart, and the effect that they roll is the effect that happens when the wizard casts that spell. Like for example, they can roll on the mercurial magic chart and get, say they learn Scorching Ray, level 2 spell. Well, once they've scribed it in their book, they then roll the mercurial magic chart. So, and they might roll and get something like, I don't know, lose a finger. So every time they cast Scorching Ray, they lose a finger. Or they might roll Sweat and Blood, or they might roll, one of my favourites is the Philosopher's Curse, where every time they cast it, a random item on the party turns to lead and another one turns to gold. Anything here in the Cries of a Dying God is quite fun. But these are the things that happen every time that spell is cast, that one thing. And then finally they get patron bonding, which is like the 5th edition warlock. They can swear fealty to a otherworldly creature or an otherworldly being, and that being will grant them abilities. So yeah, like a warlock really. Okay, so on to rolling the dice. Now this is where it differs a little. Both use your bog standard role playing dice, so your d20s, your d4s, your d8s, your d6s, and so on. With 5th edition, obviously you've got advantage and disadvantage, which for those that don't know, advantage you roll a d20 and pick the highest, 2d20 pick the highest, and then obviously with disadvantage you roll 2d20 pick the lowest. However, DCC differs from this, and they use the bog standard role playing dice, but they also use Zocchi dice, which are specialist dice created by a guy called Zocchi, and they are D3, D5, D7, D14, D16, D24, and D30. And instead of advantage and disadvantage, DCC uses what's known as the dice chain. So you start at D20 for everything. And if you get an advantage, then you can roll D24 or D30. If you get a disadvantage, then you roll D16, D14, and yeah. It can get, this is one thing that I don't like about DCC is using these dice, because they can be hard to get, and if you don't know your way around how to do it with normal dice, then you're pretty much scuppered. However, there's one thing I do like in DCC, that is the crit fail and the crit hit charts. Each class gets their own, some monsters get their own, and also the crit fail The higher you roll, the worse it gets, and that is also, you add your armor onto that, and you also, your luck lowers it. Okay, so let's move on. Magical items. So this is, again, a little different. In D&D, you just usually get a magic item or create it, you set rules, yeah. DCC, every time you find a magical item, you roll the chart, and it tells you everything from that magical item, like how it communicates, is it a lawful sort, if it's a lawful item, does it summon what does it have any magical abilities, if so, what are they? It's just a huge chart. Also, creating magical items, the wizard has a few spells. Create a staff, create a sword, and create potion. Create a sword, which for higher difficulty, if you put it in a higher difficulty, it can be any weapon. And then again, depending on the number rolled, goes onto a chart. Wizards, with the staff, they roll on, it's like normal magic, they roll. The higher they get, allows them to do more things, so the staff can create light, but it can also add. You're sort of like, you can add level 1, level 2, and level 3 spells to it, but you have to roll spell casting for each of the spells. So, for example, you might say, right, I've got 4 charges of level 1, 4 charges of level 2, so you roll 4d20, 2 of them succeed, and you get 2 charges of that spell. And then and that's how they do it for the staff, so it creates some randomness, it creates a bit of creative freedom for a wizard staff, because every wizard staff is then different. With a potion, you just roll on the chart, and whatever your spellcasting roll is the list of potions you can create. Very simple. Again, the create sword one is like 3 or 4 different charts, and each sword is totally different. Yeah, it can get a bit overwhelming, but again, you get a little bit of randomness, a bit of freedom, and that's what makes that fun, really. Okay, venturing and monsters. Now, DCC and D&D are similar in the adventuring aspects, just because it's got dungeon crawl in the title, or because it's got Dungeons and Dragons in the title. It's still a point saying, oh, Dungeon Crawl Classic is just dungeon crawling. It's not. Dungeon crawl is a dirty word, I don't like it. Adventures can take place anywhere, they both can have court intrigue. And then you've got Dungeons and Dragons, but you don't see, it's not like, oh, you call it Dungeons and Dragons every time you fight a dragon, because, well, you don't. So it's, again, they're both the similar really when it comes to adventures, and really differences in D&D, your heroes, and in Dungeon Crawl Classics, your adventurers and cut purses and reavers and that type of stuff. So the 5th edition, you got the monster manual, and it's just tons of monsters. They're organised by a challenge rating, which means, so if the challenge rating is 2, that means 4 level 2 characters could be a similar power to that monster. I think this creates cardboard cutouts for monsters. I think the monsters just become cardboardy cutout and a little bit boring. But I cannot argue the ease of this for new dungeon masters who are in a rush to just create adventure, fill it with monsters. Really easy for them to do with this. DCC system, this is the system I'm used to and I like it, but it's not for everybody. It uses hit dice. Some of your monsters do have charts to give them a bit of personality, but again, it can be very overwhelming because the hit dice doesn't really match with a level. Just because a monster has 2d8 hit that has two hit dice doesn't mean it's a level 2 monster. Also, DCC only gives you a few monsters, so you're going to have to use a bit of brain power, and if you really want to create some epic adventures, you're going to have to create your own monsters, and it can be very difficult. There are sites out there, there's stuff on the internet that you can use to randomly create these monsters and help you out a bit, but you are going to have to do some of the work. And for someone who's trying to just create a quick adventure with some monsters, yeah, it's not going to work for DCC. You're going to have to really put some time into creating an adventure.
So, after hearing me ramble on, I have come to a conclusion. If you like to get a game that's easy to pick up and play, take no time to create a character, take no time to take an adventure and fill it with monsters, if you just want an easy time of it, and play 5th edition. I do feel that sometimes when I play 5th edition, I have to get across like very firmly that my wizard is different than that guy's wizard, or my fighter is different than that guy's fighter. But it's very simple and fun to play in that respect. If you want to create a character that's your own, that you take time to build, and they're happy to share in there, then yeah, DCC is your game. DCC is a lot more brutal. Characters can die a lot easy. Especially when you start at the beginning and you're playing peasants. You have an attachment to them, but you don't. But you can chronicle when Sir Steve of Steventon died epically against 50 orcs, and you can recount that. Have fun with it, then yeah, DCC is your game. Again, for judges, which is the DCC DMs. Again, if you like to spend a bit and adding a bit of life to your monsters, as opposed to just reading a chart and having a challenge rate, and then again, DCC is your game. I like both systems. I like D&D for its simplicity, but I like DCC for its more creative aspects. But personally, I think you should play both games. And after playing both games, then you should be the judge. Pun intended. Well, this is your humble wizard, Archmage Feng, signing off. And adventure on.